The patrons have spoken, and they have told us that it is time for Mr. Mime and Mr. Rime. One of the wackier Pokemon from the original 151, Mr. Mime has been clowning around for a while, most notably in some of the funniest Indigo League episodes that led to it receiving a recurring role, as it was taken in by Ash's mom. Those who have played Red, Blue, and Yellow, or Fire Red and Leaf Green, may have also made an in-game trade for a Mr. Mime named Marcel, Miles, or Mimeon, depending on your version. In more modern times, Mr. Mime also had a notable appearance in Detective Pikachu, and in Generation 8, it received an icy Galarian form and evolved into Mr. Rime, completing its journey to becoming a three-stage evolution Pokemon that began in Generation 4 with the addition of its adorable pre-evolution, Mime Jr. Today, we'll be examining if Mr. Mime was effectively able to fake it until it made it in the competitive scene, and if Mr. Rime's icy cane was good for more than just a tap routine. And so, we ask, how good were Mr. Mime and Mr. Rime actually? And in this video, we'll be going over these competitive formats. For a Generation 1 Psychic type, Mr. Mime had it pretty rough. It's not that it was bad, it's that it had to compete with a lot of other top-tier Psychics. Its stats were decent, but there was no way it was ever finding its way onto an OU team over Alakazam, Starmie, Exeggutor, or Jinx, who had both superior stats and move pools. It wasn't much better in UU either, as it was similarly outclassed by Kadabra and Hypno, who were two of the best Pokemon in the tier. The former was much faster and stronger, crucially outspeeding Tentacruel and packing Recover to boot, while the latter was incredibly bulky and could shut something down with Hypnosis. Some players thought Mr. Mime might have a place alongside those Pokemon on a triple Psychic team, but ultimately concluded that Mr. Mime was just not worth using in the tier at all. However, with the recent development of RBYNU, Mr. Mime finally found a home in Generation 1. It was the strongest Psychic type remaining. Thus, as was the way of Gen 1 Psychic, it established itself as one of the tier's best Pokemon. Mime's powerful Stab Psychic destroyed several common Pokemon, such as fellow top tiers Poliwrath and Nidoking, and was generally immensely difficult to switch into, given the tier only had a few options to resist it. Opposing Mr. Mime wouldn't want to switch in, as they would be ruined by Thunder Wave, while Slowpoke was obliterated by Thunderbolt. The best check was Execute, who was a great Pokemon in its own right and didn't much mind paralysis. Drowsy was a great check, but it wasn't used as much since it didn't do much besides checking Mr. Mime. As such, Mr. Mime easily exerted a ton of pressure on every type of team. Of course, Mr. Mime was not without its flaws. Its utterly pitiful base 40 HP meant it wasn't the sturdiest hit taker. Its base 90 speed was good, but not great, and its psychic was powerful, but not to the point where it instantly dropped neutral targets. Thus, while Mr. Mime was strong, it was not effortlessly bowling over other top tier Pokemon like Raichu, Raticate, and Fearow. Of course, this is not to downplay how threatening it was. While one couldn't be careless with throwing Mime into battle, given its relative frailty and susceptibility to paralysis, it was terrifying once it did hit the field, given how many Pokemon it ripped through, especially the tier's plethora of water types. Overall, it took it a while to find it, but Mr. Mime had its own solid role to play in the Psychic generation. The second generation bestowed a bevy of boons upon Mr. Mime. First, it was a beneficiary of the special stat splitting, receiving an impressive special defense stat of 120. Second, it got a ton of great new moves: Fire Punch, Ice Punch, Hypnosis, Baton Pass, Encore, and Thief, as well as being able to heal reliably through Rest and Sleep Talk. Even its electric coverage got buffed. It could now feasibly brandish Thunder, whose paralysis had been beefed up to an impressive 30%. Finally, it loved being able to passively heal with leftovers, which was effectively another buff to its bulk. Now, it still wasn't touching OU. The same excellent psychics that had gatekept it before did so still, as did new arrival Espeon. There were some attempts to make it work on dedicated Baton Pass teams, but Mr. Mime was too gimmicky even for a playstyle already to be on the gimmicky side. Once again, it dropped to NU. This time around, it did not settle for simply being one of the tier's best Pokemon. It was without a doubt the single biggest threat in the metagame. Mr. Mime utterly destroyed the few Pokemon in the tier that resisted psychic. Its electric coverage trucked Zatu and Houndour, while its improved coverage in Fire Punch let it now effortlessly dispose of its old enemy Execute, whilst also ripping through Sneasel and the newly steel Magnemite. Mr. Mime wasn't so dominant that it quickly established itself as not just the best Pokemon and psychic type in the tier, but as so much better than the other psychics that to use any of them instead of Mr. Mime would just be making your team worse. It was so difficult to handle Mr. Mime that most of the time, the best option was to use your own. In other words, to literally mime the opponent in every sense. defense. A lot of Mime engaged in rest talk stalemates, since switching out to any of their teammates would risk immense damage or a KO for nothing in return. When given the choice of stalling the opposing Mr. Mime with your own or letting the opposing Mr. Mime destroy all your other Pokemon, you took the former option every time. Mr. Mime wasn't even a perfect counter to itself. Some Mr. Mime slotted Hidden Power Dark or Shadow Ball, making itself even more insanely difficult to counter. It was just that Mr. Mime was the least flawed option for the role, and it did get the job done most of the time. Fortuitously, the NU player base was relieved of this incredibly unhealthy Mime on Mime dynamic, for as it turned out, Mr. Mime was the real deal in UU as well. Though initially overlooked, it wound up establishing itself as not just viable, but one of the best choices in that tier as well, eventually moving up to a genuine UU Pokemon. Its fearsome psychic ripped through tier Queen Nidoqueen, while also scoring lethal super effective hits on other top tier standards Quillfish, Crobat, and Victory Bell. Its strength was such that common neutral targets such as Granbull didn't want to take it either. What made Mr. Mime especially threatening was that with Thunder, it effortlessly tore through two of the tier's most popular psychic resists, the Slow Twins. This was the main reason Mr. Mime's electric coverage was so valuable, but another one nearly as significant was that it severely threatened other popular water types that could take psychic decently. Blastoise, Politoed, Kabutops, and Gyarados, which increased the amount of opportunities Mr. Mime had to place instant pressure on the opponent. Mr. Mime's incredible move pool was on full display in UU. It could mix and match its set to threaten basically everything in the tier. A Magneton hoping to resist the Psychic Thunder combination would get thrashed by Fire Punch, a move that also put much more pressure on the popular tanks Blossom and Piloswine. Hypno and Chansey looking to absorb Mr. Mime's combination of attacks and status would get crippled by Thief stealing their leftovers. Anything attempting to boost could get locked into the move by Encore, which Mr. Mime used to gleefully create even more opportunities to wreak havoc. Thunder Wave ruined Scyther and Electabuzz. Rest Talk allowed Mr. Mime to shrug off Toxics and Thunder Waves and continue trucking. Put simply, Mr. Mime was absolutely amazing. It could do anything you wanted to, and it was excellent on a game-to-game basis against any kind of team. Overall, the second generation was quite a good time for Mr. Mime. Mr. Mime enjoyed the third generation's edition of Calm Mind. However, it will not be sweeping through OU anytime soon. It was thoroughly and entirely outclassed by Jirachi. Trick was something Mr. Mime could do that Jirachi couldn't, but Alakazam could do that as well, while also outclassing Mr. Mime entirely, and Alakazam wasn't too great in its own right. Mr. Mime was only passable in UU this time around. As a Calm Mind baton passer, it was outdone by Lunatone and Hypno, who both had far better defensive utility, and neither Roar nor Parish Sound were common enough in UU to necessitate the use of Mr. Mime's soundproof ability. As a standalone Pokemon, it had fierce competition in the excellent Grumpig, who could also trick while possessing excellent resistances to fire and ice by virtue of its thick fat ability. Sadly, Mr. Mime wasn't given the opportunity to drop to NU. It's unlikely it would have lasted long, but at least it would have gotten to blast the tier apart briefly before getting banned. Now, this sounds like Mr. Mime had a thoroughly forgettable third generation, and it is true that most of the time it didn't see any sort of play. However, it was always lurking beneath the surface, posing a threat that was potentially as unbeatable as anything can be in Pokemon, Baton Pass. Of course, Mr. Mime wasn't a standalone passer in the vein of Celebi. However, Mr. Mime was an integral Pokemon for dedicated teams of Baton Pass chain. It was an effective enough booster with access to Calm Mind, as well as the option to create further opportunities for itself through Encore. Mr. Mime was effective at creating unbreakable substitutes on the special side, while being able to pass to Acid Armor Vaporeon against physical attackers. All the duo needed was to receive the speed boost from Ninjas, and they were good to go. They would freely boost up and then hand the boost off to a teammate, continuing the chain, protecting against KOs from ill-timed critical hits via substitute, which quickly became unbreakable for most attacks thanks to the boost they would easily accrue more rapidly than the opponent could respond to. Once enough boosts had been accumulated, they would be passed to the final sweeper, usually Zapdos, Medicham, Marowak, or Octillery, and the game would be over. The reason Mr. Mime was so crucial for these teams as opposed to Celebi was soundproof. It single-handedly turned Roar and the occasional Parish Song from destroyers of Baton Pass chains to completely useless. The unreliable, inconsistent nature of Baton Pass teams meant their usage tended to fluctuate. However, in more recent times, the style became more and more optimized. Previously, it had been seen as a gimmick that could potentially cheese wins, but now it came to be viewed as just blatantly overpowered, requiring overly specific counters and making team building much more difficult and matchup prone as a result, which wasn't at all a desirable quality for a metagame as prized criticized for its balance and lack of polarization as advanced. Many players felt that certain forms of baton pass, such as Calm Mind or Swords Dance Pass Celebi, were healthy parts of the tier that should be preserved. However, full chains were seen as problematic. When the metagame had begun regaining popularity, Ingrained Smeargle was banned in an attempt to nerf these chains, as it would leave them vulnerable to Whirlwind Skarmory. Indeed, Whirlwind Skarmory was one of the main arguments against Baton Pass's brokenness, since it was such a powerful common Pokemon, and Whirlwind wasn't a sound-based move, meaning it would successfully phase out Mr. Mime unaffected by Soundproof. In the early days of Baton Pass, Mr. Mime sometimes slotted in Thunderbolt, which would KO more physically oriented Skarmory after a Calm Mind. However, this was unreliable since Skarmory would ruin Ninjask's all-important Speed Pass prior, and most players wanting to use Mr. Mime chose to simply hope they would not encounter Skarmory, especially since Encore was so much better in every other situation. It was hoped that without the option of Ingrained Smeargle to bypass phasing entirely, full chains would be sufficiently neutered since they would now risk losing to Whirlwind Skarmory. However, these teams persisted, mostly off the strength of Smeargle, and thus a 3 Baton Pass limit was instated alongside a Baton Pass ban on Smeargle, who had also been wreaking havoc with Belly Drum passing. This solution hoped to find a happy medium that maintained as many strategies as possible while cutting out the most overpowered elements. However, even with these types of limitations, certain types of Baton Pass continued to prove problematic. At long last, the primary issue came to light. The reason these teams were often so difficult to deal with largely stemmed from Mime's ability to invalidate Roar as a response. It was generally considered reasonable to slot Roar on most teams to act as a check to offensive Baton Pass attempts from Pokemon like Zapdos or the aforementioned Celebi. However, this was entirely worthless against Mr. Mime. Whirlwind Skarmory and Roar Tyranitar did nearly single-handedly beat these teams, the latter as a result of Mr. Mime not wanting to switch into it and thus allowing Roar to be pulled off. And those two were indeed amazing Pokemon. However, dealing with Baton Pass often felt like using one of these two or risking a near automatic loss, and that was simply not a healthy dynamic to have in the tier, no matter how good they were. It was unreasonable to risk losing to Baton Pass because you did impact not just those Pokemon, but those sets on those Pokemon. Roar Tyranitar was great, but it was just about the furthest thing from an essential move as one would get. Even Skarmory didn't always want to use Whirlwind. Sometimes it wanted to use Roar because that was compatible with Dropek, while Whirlwind was not. In the old metagame, some Skarmory used HP Flying as their stab, just so they could Whirlwind out Mime safely, which was of course far worse in every non-Baton Pass matchup, but it was necessary to prevent automatic losses. This kind of extreme polarization was the core reason why Baton Pass was so unhealthy and overpowered. Several solutions were thrown around for quite some time. While many considered a 2 Baton Pass limit, some players clamored for Mr. Mime itself to be banned, or at least the move Baton Pass on Mr. Mime. Eventually, after a certain high-stakes tournament battle that showed the absurd power of the style that had been warned against for so long, it was agreed that these teams threatened the competitive integrity of the metagame. Previously, these teams had been seen as too unreliable for anyone to want to risk bringing to a tournament, but it was now clear that that was no longer the case. These teams were just straight up broken, and Mr. Mime was the main reason why. As a result, after much deliberation, Mr. Mime was indeed banned at long last. In fact, right before the writing and release of this video, it remains to be seen if this is the final death blow to the problematic types of Baton Pass in advance, but now Roar is finally a viable choice once more, or at least more viable than it was before. Mr. Mime, on the other hand, resides in Ubers. We assure you this is not some delayed April Fool's prank. This actually happened, and if you're interested, you can look it up yourself. Generation 4 was quite a step down for Mr. Mime. The OU Baton Pass teams it featured on were far weaker than in the previous generation as a result of immense power creep, were almost never seen, and were rarely successful when they were seen. These full pass teams were eventually optimized to the point of getting banned several years later, but they did so without relying on Mr. Mime to stop Roar. They did this through Ingrained Smeargle, Taunt Gliscor, and Taunt Hypno, the three of which also stopped Whirlwind Skarmory. Mr. Mime wasn't much use in UU either. Baton Pass teams weren't very good. Standalone passing was done much better by the far bulkier Hypno, and Mr. Mime wasn't at all a good standalone attacker, as while sweeping with its newly gained Nasty Plot sounded fun, having this better boosting move did not make it any less outclassed by Alakazam. So to NU, Mr. Mime went once more. The Baton Pass situation was identical to that in UU, but this time around, Mr. Mime wasn't a bad Pokemon in its own right. It was actually quite decent, it's just that it existed in the shadow of two other psychic types that easily eclipsed it in the power and move pool department, Jinx and Gardevoir, otherwise known as two of the best Pokemon in the tier. Mr. Mime's new ability Filter was potentially highly useful, but sadly Mr. Mime was just too frail for the ability to be able to meaningfully differentiate it from its psychic competition. The fourth generation was definitely Mr. Mime's worst so far. Sadly, Mime Jr. wasn't very good in Little Cup either, as it was just about entirely outclassed by Abra. The Choice Scarf set was pretty cool on fun teams though. Mr. Mime did appear on full chain OU Baton Pass teams once again, but its anti-phasing qualities had never been in lower demand, as the incredible Magic Bounce Espeon took care of that easily. Instead, Mr. Mime's job was relegated to stopping Parish Song, which was quite important as the move was at its most common since GSC. Parish Song featured on many Politoed sets and was a staple on specially defensive Celebi. Mime's Encore was also useful in thwarting attempts to set up alongside the Baton Pass team from the many threatening sweepers the 5th generation brought, such as Terrakion and Volcarona. It took some time, but full Baton Pass chains were eventually banned, and Mr. Mime was center stage in stretching the strategy to the fullest limit of its broken potential. Sometimes it even used Thunder to destroy Haze Politoed, who only used the move in an attempt to counter Baton Pass, but wound up failing even at that. Mr. Mime really was synonymous with Baton Pass at this point. Sadly, once Baton Pass was gone, so was Mr. Mime. Once again, it couldn't establish a niche for itself in NU. Masharna thoroughly outclassed it as a Baton Passer, while being a much better defensive Pokemon overall, and Gardevoir still outdid Mime defensively. Thus, Mr. Mime justifiably wound up untiered. It speaks to the sheer ridiculous power of Baton Pass when a Pokemon can be uber with it and untiered without it. With Generation 6 Baton Pass coming to focus on instant sweeps, with entire teams sacrificing themselves to facilitate Geomancy Cotton Guard Smeargle, Mr. Mime no longer really had a place on such teams. However, that was just fine because the 6th generation brought the new fairy type and bestowed it upon Mr. Mime as a secondary typing. One could say Mr. Mime did Tapu Lele before Tapu Lele did, as it mimed so well it predicted the future. Nobody mentioned anything about its old nemesis Gardevoir doing the same thing while also receiving a Mega, because that's when Mr. Mime starts to mime unsavory things. Anyway, Mr. Mime wasn't going to be overtaking OU or anything, and sadly, its new secondary stab of Dazzling Gleam wasn't enough to vault it back into NU. However, in another fortuitous twist of fate, the 6th generation introduced PU, the new lowest tier below NU, and there Mr. Mime established itself as one of the best Pokemon around, entirely on its own merits. No Baton Pass at all. Its flagship variant was the Choice Scarfer, which was a terrific revenge killer for popular offensive Pokemon like Monfernal and Stoutland. Its stabs were also highly effective at finishing off weakened teams late game, especially as it got the jump on many teams' own Scarf Pokemon, Rotom Frost. What really made it great though was how it could effectively utilize utility moves as well, which lent a great deal of depth to how it could be played. It could revive a battered teammate with Healing Wish, or it could cripple an obnoxious wall like Clefairy with Trick. Scarf was far from the only set Mr. Mime could run effectively though. With Nasty Plot or Choice Specs, it was the scourge of defensive teams, with boosted Psy Shocks crushing specially defensive behemoths like Audino and Regice. It wasn't just a wall breaker though. Thanks to Mime's solid speed tier, it was still highly effective against offensive teams. Furthermore, while Mr. Mime didn't have much in the way of defensive utility, it did possess one very important immunity. With Soundproof, it completely blanked one of the most dangerous attacks in the tier, Chatot's Boom Burst. Overall, Mr. Mime was one of the best, most important Pokemon in the ORAZ PU metagame. Mr. Mime's lackluster defenses and middling speed leave it hard-pressed to find a place in the VGC metagame, where it risks being one-hit KO'd before it can even apply what little offensive pressure it has. However, Mr. Mime's imaginary barriers and big hands give it access to a wide range of support moves, including Wide Guard, Quick Guard, and Fake Out. In typical fashion, it was Wolf Glick who first showed what Mr. Mime could do. Wolf brought Mr. Mime to the 2014 Virginia Regionals alongside Mega Lucario. Wolf used Mime as a valuable support mon that could beat Double Dragon leads such as Garchomp and Salamence, a very strong pairing in the 2014 meta. Mime's fairy typing aided with this, but it was more of a defensive bonus. It was Icy Wind, not Dazzling Gleam, that Wolf used to stop the dragons in their tracks. With Fake Out, Icy Wind, and Wide Guard, Mr. Mime was able to gain and control momentum early on for its teammates. While there are a few other mons who can use both Fake Out and Icy Wind, Mime's typing and decent special attack made it a great Double Dragon counter. Safety Goggles and Psy Shock let it handle the Amoongus matchup well, and in total, Wolf's team finished 5th at the Virginia Regionals. While a few other players attempted to use Mime in the same way Wolf did, they didn't see as much success. However, there was another breed of Mime that did see some use. While Wolf tricked out Mr. Mime with its signature ability, Filter, to let it stay on the field as long as possible, other players tried to put one of Mr. Mime's other abilities to use, Soundproof. This decision was actually motivated by another Pokemon entirely, Exploud. Exploud, while mediocre in most other aspects, had access to scrappy Boom Burst, meaning it could dish out pretty wide spread damage, even more so if Life Orb or Choice Specs boosted. Mr. Mime's aforementioned support moves let it help Exploud do its job, while Soundproof meant it didn't have to worry about the sonic waves emanating from its partner. The player who found the most success with the strategy was Bridger Snow, who managed to play 16th at Long Beach Regionals with it. However, Mime and Exploud was only one aspect of Bridger's team. He also used Mime as support to his Mega Charizard Y. Bridger valued Mime's ability to handle dragons, but he also had a weird trick up his sleeve, Trick Room. Bridger's Charizard was unusually slow, so opponents didn't see it coming. In addition to the good Fairy and Fire synergy, where Mime handled dragons with Dazzling Gleam and Zard toasted steel types, Bridger highly valued Mime's ability to use both Wide and Quick Guard. Wide Guard for the plethora of spread moves that threaten Zard, such as Rock Slide, Muddy Water, and Surf, and Quick Guard for things like Talonflame, Brave Bird. Bridger actually forewent Fake Out on Mime to put this combo together and gave it a Lumberry to ensure it wouldn't be stopped by any status. In fact, Mime's strategy with Charizard was so good that Bridger dropped Exploud from the team entirely after that, attending Salt Lake Regionals with a version of the team that focused more on the stronger Trick Room mons such as Scrafty, Trevenant, and Rhyhorn. By removing Exploud, Bridger was free to run Filter, and he rebalanced Mr. Mime's EV spread to give it some admirable bulk that could let it do things such as Living Bisharp and Mega Gengar stab move. These adjustments greatly helped the team and led Bridger to a bronze medal finish in Salt Lake, giving Mr. Mime a second top cut for the 2014 season. OU Baton Pass had no need for Mr. Mime in the short time it was in the tier. It continued in the vein of Oras, with quick setup pass to monsters like Necrozma and Magearna in addition to Espeon, as opposed to the prolonged chains that Mime had been an integral part of. That was to be expected, but this time there was no respite waiting for Mime in PU. The lowest tier had undergone insane power creep, with Jinx joining the tier and in doing so ensuring that Mr. Mime stood no chance at viability. The only thing Mr. Mime could do was use Soundproof to block Drampa's Hyper Voice or Alolan Persian's Parting Shot. It actually walled Drampa, which was pretty amusing, but this was still the absolute smallest of small niches because Mime simply didn't do anything else, and as such was not used for good reason. Thus, it returned to untiered. Mr. Mime popped up on people's radars again very briefly in 2018, with two players using it to top 8 special events. Alex Terrazas placed 8th in Cancun, with a really unique team also utilizing Komo-O, Butterfree, Mega Gengar, Tapu Bulu, and Incineroar. And Ike Marvin Gilshire placed 8th in Taiwan. Ike's team in particular was pretty devilish. You might remember us mentioning his team early in our video on Chansey, and Mime was an essential part to tightening up Ike's timer stall based strategy. The biggest thing Mime had going for it was skill swap with Soundproof, which was a defense Ike had prepared to safeguard his Chansey against any Perish Song strategies while its setup minimized. However, that wasn't the only utility that Mr. Mime provided. Ike's Mr. Mime was full support, totally geared around supporting Chansey. In addition to skill swap, Mime also had a Trick Room and a Macho Brace to let it get skill swaps off faster in Trick Room. It also came packing Wide Guard, which was essential in protecting Chansey strategies from one of the primary challengers to their success, Turn 1 Rock Slide Flinches. Finally, Ike gave his Mime Encore as his last move to stall opponents into setup moves or make them predictable, and while he said he didn't click it much in practice, it was apparently an essential part of practice. One other tidbit, Ike actually ended up thinking Mime Jr. was better for the team than Mr. Mime because of how slow it was, and so he used some Mime Jr. teams in the weeks afterwards. So every member of the evolutionary line gets a chance in VGC. Special thanks to Ike Marvin Gilshire for the information. Generation 8 NU and PU in Early Home and Isle of Armor, respectively, were in large part characterized by the immense wall-breaking power of Drampa. Mr. Mime briefly rose up as a great check to it in both metagames. It was much more valuable this time around, since it did more than just check Drampa, as thanks to the smaller Pokedex, it was able to match up much better against the lower overall power and walling level of these tiers. Its Gen 6 Choice Scarf set was excellent once again, especially with the buff to Healing Wish, that now could be stored if the Pokemon switching in after Mime was at full health and unstatus, meaning Mime had even more flexibility in pulling off efficient healing wishes. As a revenge killer, it was as good as ever. Its stabs picked off large swaths of popular, dangerous offensive threats, such as Phalanx and Stonejourner, while threatening to clean weakened teams up late game. It was no slouch against bulkier Pokemon either. Trick would ruin the likes of Type Null, Pukumuku, and Masharna. Mr. Mime was excellent in these two metagames, but sadly this was brought to an end all too soon by the Crown Tundra, which reintroduced the power creep Mime had been so happy to get away from. As a result, out, it dropped to untiered once again. However, we are far from done with Mr. Mime's family in Generation 8. First off, Mr. Mime received a Galarian form that swapped out its secondary fairy typing for ice. It lost a bit of special attack and special defense, but gained HP and speed. It also received Rapid Spin, which was buffed significantly in Generation 8. While its boost to 50 base power wasn't really relevant to Galarian Mr. Mime, the plus 1 speed boost certainly was, making it even more threatening alongside Nasty Plot, and while providing excellent team utility to boot. Speaking of boots, the heavy duty ones meant Galarian Mr. Mime need not be plagued by its newfound Stealth Rock weakness, though it certainly made solid use of other items, such as Choice Scarf and Eviolite. Finally, it received 3 amazing abilities in Ice Body, Vital Spirit, and the brand new Screen Cleaner, which allowed G Mr. Mime to remove the effects of Light Screen, Reflect, and Aurora Veil upon entry. While G Mime lacked the stats to make an impact on the higher tiers, it certainly packed a litany of interesting utilities for the lower tiers. The possibilities were plentiful, and hopes were high. But we're not done, though. We just mentioned how Galarian Mr. Mime could run Eviolite, and this was because it was indeed a not fully evolved Pokemon. It now evolved into Mr. Rime, who was essentially a slower but bulkier and stronger version of G Mr. Mime. This bulk was especially noticeable because Mr. Rime also gained recovery in Slack Off, accentuating its improved hit-taking ability even further. Its stats weren't high enough to warrant its weakness-laden typing in the higher tiers. It started out in NU in the home metagame right alongside Galarian Mr. Mime, since the two were among the limited choices the tier had for hazard removal. However, this did not last. Soon, Mr. Rime dropped to PU, and there it immediately became a staple with its choice spec set, which was a ferocious wall breaker thanks to its high-powered stabs coming off of its already strong special attack stat boosted even further. It was practically impossible to switch into without one's own Mr. Rime. Well, not any old Mr. Rime set, specifically the specially defensive variant, which provided great utility in not only countering the scariest threat in the tier, as well as others like Raichu and Ludicolo, but also clearing the field of hazards with Rapid Spin, as well as countering the most dangerous wall breaker. Mr. Rime wasn't just a defensive spinner though, it was quite potent when used on offensive heavy duty boost sets as well, since Rapid Spin let it bypass the issue of its speed, making it more threatening against offensive teams. It still hit plenty hard, so losing choice specs wasn't much of an obstacle, and it of course still supported its team against hazards. Nasty Plot variants were quite threatening as well, as Mr. Rime still outsped much of the metagame and dropped just about everything at plus 2 special attack. It could easily still fit Rapid Spin in its moveset too. All forms of spin Rime were valuable given how difficult it could be to fit hazard removal on teams otherwise, especially since it meant Mr. Rime could afford to run heavy duty boots as its item. The choice spec set had neither of these luxuries, but it was still used because it was just that dangerous. Mr. Rime was one of the best, most defining PU Pokemon in the home metagame. Speaking of home, near the end of its tenure, Galarian Mr. Mime finally dropped from NU into PU. However, it was generally seen as a worse Mr. Rime. Then the Isle of Armor came around, and with it came Kling Klang, which quickly established itself as one of the most dominant threats in the tier. Its ability to outspeed Mr. Rime was a big part of what made it so threatening. It was here that Galarian Mr. Mime took its cue to rise up as a threat. Its speed advantage over its evolution was huge, as it was able to get the jump on Kling Klang and destroy it with Focus Blast. As a result, G Mime easily matched the usage of its evolution during this period. With Nasty Plot or Rapid Spin, G Mr. Mime could play quite similarly to the same sets Mr. Rime had used prior, with the amazing benefit of not being valuable to the metagame defining Kling Klang. This made it a particularly terrifying Nasty Plot sweeper, as many teams were unable to deal with its boosted stabs without Kling Klang being able to outspeed it as it would Mr. Rime. Of course, Mr. Rime was still top tier, as Kling Klang didn't want to actually switch into it. It's just that giving Kling Klang opportunities to set up in revenge was generally not good given how difficult it was to deal with, and sacrificing Mr. Rime to prevent it from doing so was far from ideal. If Mr. Rime was paired with multiple Pokemon that could check Kling Klang well, then Kling Klang eventually coming in was not the end of the world, so it was usually the preferred choice. However, checking Kling Klang was so difficult for most teams that it was the end of the world if it got a free turn, and for that reason, Galarian Mr. Mime was generally preferred overall, as it freed up slots in team building by virtue of not being thwarted by the gears. Galarian Mr. Mime was also quite an effective choice scarfer, pushing its speed to the maximum to abuse the frailty most teams had against Ice Beam, taking away their ability to outspeed it without needing a turn to use Rapid Spin. When Kling Klang was eventually banned near the end of Isle of Armor, both Mr. Rime and Galarian Mr. Mime seemed poised to completely dominate the tier, and some even speculated that they would both be broken. This hopeful period lasted all of 2 weeks, when tier shifts not only returned Kling Klang to NU, but also brought Kangaskhan and Lipard as well. The presence of the latter two was so strong that both Mr. Rime and Galarian Mr. Mime were basically completely knocked out of the metagame. Come the Crown Tundra, power creep increased even further, and they were gone for good. Land ending in untiered. It was a cruelly abrupt, jarring end for the duel, but at least they were elite for a time. Remember how I said every part of the evolutionary line got a chance in VGC? Well, as we know, Mr. Mime got a new form and an evolution in Gen 8, but they might prove me a liar. While Galarian Mime and Mr. Rime's screen cleaner ability could seem useful against dual screen strategies, Lapras or Grimmsnarl anyone, their ice typing did not make them viable picks, especially when combined with the rest of their lackluster stats. There were a few scattered attempts to make them work, but alas, Galar is not a friendly place for the Mimes. But congratulations to Samuel Harzma for placing with it. And that's it. So how good were Mr. Mime and Mr. Rime actually? Well, for the most part, Mr. Mime has been a career lower tier Pokemon, displaying excellence in several different generations of NU, with excellent displays in GSC UU and ORAS PU as well. It's also been untiered a couple of times, but it has been scores more successful than most other Pokemon who share this rank with it. This was just on its own though. As part of a baton pass chain, Mr. Mime saw some use in OU, playing a key role in maintaining accrued boosts by virtue of its soundproof ability, ignoring Roar and Parish Song. It was a key part of full chains being banned in Gen 5, and even with the severely limited nature of Gen 3 Baton Pass, it was so effective at facilitating unstoppable sweeps that it was banned entirely. In Generation 8, it gained a Galarian form and an evolution to that Galarian form in Mr. Rime. Both these Pokemon eventually became elite cornerstones of the PU metagames themselves at the same time. Sure, they eventually wound up untiered as well, but they were defining pieces of the tier for quite some time. Overall, Mr. Mime has had an absolutely wild competitive history. Thanks for watching, everyone, and thank you so much to our patrons for continued support of our videos and for voting this Pokemon for this month's patron pick. And if you like the video and you want to see more, be sure to subscribe to Falswipe Gaming for more weekly Pokemon content. And in the comments, I want to know, what do you think about competitive Mr. Mime and Mr. Rime? How would you buff it even more? Whatever it is, let me know in the comments. Follow my crew on these social media platforms, and that's all I got. See you next time, everyone.